Good morning. Welcome to Common Ground Church. What a time of worship that was. Start to the service. We're super glad that you are here. If you're a guest with us, my name is Matt McDonald. Have the privilege of being the lead pastor here at CGC. We are wrapping up the month of January already, 2024. It's hard to believe. How many have accomplished their New Year's resolution? I'm not going to say quit. Just accomplished it, like it's already done. It's disappointing. It's disappointing. I did. Mine was the floss. I did it. 12:01, midnight. Blood everywhere. But I did it. And now I'm done with my New Year's resolution. So I hope that you all accomplish your New Year's resolution as well. We're going to be in the book of Joshua today, Joshua chapter 1. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn there. We have been in this series before today to start the year off called Set Apart. We've had some of our different leaders and church members speaking and preaching through the month of January, some online-only messages as well as some messages from Sunday morning. Just incredible, incredible teachings and messages that we've had. Want to encourage you, if you missed any of it, go check it out. It was basically the heartbeat of the series was holiness. What does God's word actually say about holiness? What does God say about holiness? And for me, it's always a good time to take a pause and take a look at how God defines holiness versus sometimes how I'm tempted to define holiness, meaning perfection, perfect behavior, versus who actually makes us holy and where we pursue God out of, the place that we pursue God out of. Because God is holy. We are called to be holy as Christ was holy, but we are not holy like God is holy, especially because we suffer from the same condition of humanness and imperfection and a broken world. And so it's always a good time. I love the way we started the year. This morning, I wanted to share something that has really been on my heart for a while now, for a few months. And honestly, it's sort of a personal struggle that I myself have been going through that God has given me some perspective on. But also I feel that God has prepared us for this morning. I was telling the team before we were getting ready for service that this is a personal message. Personal, not just personal from me, but personal for us. You know, we've jokingly said, you know, it's dangerous to get taco neck in church. You know what I'm talking about? When you hear the message and it's a good point, and you look down the road, you're like, you know, that was for you. I hope you're listening because he's talking about you. we're always at risk of doing that. But this is a very personal message, meaning I'm believing and I believe that God has me preparing and preaching this message for you personally. Right. Yes, it'll impact us corporately and as a whole and as the body. But I really believe that this is a message specifically for you personally, you individually. And so my prayer, my posture is that this morning, is that you will receive it personally. A word about personal perseverance. So know that as I'm preaching to you, I'm preaching to me. That usually happens throughout the week anyways and on Sundays. It doesn't always need to be said, but I felt it needed to be said this morning. So again, Joshua 1 is where we're going to be. The message title this morning is, you get to make your own. You get to listen to the message and title it how you feel the Holy Spirit speaking to you, God speaking to you, and how you would title it. So the message title really is a fill in the blank. And rather than reading the scripture up front this morning, we're going to kind of go through it and pick it apart piece by piece as we go through the message. So let's take a moment. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for your holiness. God, we thank you for your heart and your love, your kindness toward us. Then the New Testament, it said it is the kindness of God that turns people towards you in repentance. We're so grateful for that kindness, God. Lord, help us to, for maybe even if it's just for the next 30, 40 minutes, God, remove all the strings that we sometimes attach to being a child of yours. Remove all the strings that we have a tendency to attach of if we're deserving to be a child of yours. Remove all the strings that we sometimes place on if we're allowed to be a Christian, to follow you because we have done this or thought this or felt this. God, help us just to remove all those strings for the next few moments and just be ready to hear what it is you want us to hear this morning. Go remind us that we are your beloved. Lord, I pray that that we would hear the words that you're speaking to us this morning. Lord, I pray you would anoint my mind, my lips to speak your truth in love, God. It's in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, amen. I have a big desire that I'm wondering if maybe I share with you. Anybody have a big desire for things to, in your life, things to get better? A desire for improvement. I do, and it's usually most things. There's really nothing in my life, apart from a few things probably, there's really not much in my life, I would say, that I'm at the place where I'm like, I'm good. I think I'm as good as I'll ever get in this area of my life. And it's easy. I can say that, but I may not always live like that. Like, for instance, there's one maybe a low-stakes example, like golf. Anybody like to golf? I like to golf. It's fun. I am at a place in my life now, I could care less if I get any better at golf. I'm good. Like, I'm not great. I'm not awful. I am somewhere on the spectrum in between great and awful at golf. I don't know where. Depends on the day. Depends on the wind. Depends on the weather. Depends on who I'm golfing with. But I don't have a great desire to get any better. I'm comfortable with the level that I'm at because I know in order to get any better, I'm not willing to pay the investment that it's going to take. That doesn't mean I'm never going to golf again, but I'm good. Like, I could go out and golf and not slow the group down entirely, but I'm not going to necessarily impress anybody either. I can go out now and enjoy a good round of golf, and I no longer have the desire to be the best golfer that has ever lived. Although for a while there, in my mid-20s, I'm like, I'm catching Tiger. I don't know how, I don't know when, but I'm going to do it. Like, I was naive enough to, like, I'm, which is, it can be a good thing, a good motivating factor, but then I got to the point like, you know what, I'm good. I'm good never getting better at golf. Now, take for instance, I found something last year that I started to fall in love with in jiu-jitsu. I want to be the best jiu-jitsuer that has ever lived now. Not going to be, probably a long way off, but I have a strong desire to get better in that aspect of my life, and I'm willing to sacrifice the things necessary to continue to get better at that. And I think sometimes in our life, let's extend it beyond hobbies, extend it beyond likes and dislikes. I think there's certain things in our life that we've probably, maybe even unknowingly to ourselves, arrived at a place where I think I'm good. I'm good if this is all that I reach in this area of my life. For instance, if you're married, it is a dangerous position to take arriving, I think I'm as good a spouse as I'm ever going to be. I'm pretty good. I'm pretty good right now. If I get better, I might just somehow get worse, so I'm just going to stay where I'm at because I feel like I've arrived at that's a pretty dangerous position to arrive at in something as significant in our lives as marriage. But sometimes we behave like we're okay with where we've gotten in our marriage, in our relationships. We can take it in our jobs. I think it's dangerous to talk about becoming a better Christian. Because when we say things like, I need to be a better Christian, we're implying that becoming a Christian was our doing somehow. That becoming saved, that becoming a child and a person in the family of God was somehow our doing. So therefore, there's something I can do to be a better one. Versus sometimes we try so hard at being a Christian, we forget we already are one when we've accepted Jesus' sacrifice in our life. Having said that, while we're living this human experience, I think we can all agree there's areas in our life we want to improve in. I think we just need to be careful at not painting that as I want to be a better Christian. There's some areas in my life, and improvements in our life can come in many forms, right? We do it with New Year's resolutions, with goals, with wanting to grow, with wanting to get better, with wanting to persevere through hard times. And I just want to share this morning that whatever it is you're hoping for, whatever it is you're in the middle of, your improvement doesn't happen the moment you decide you want to improve, right? Like, the improvement's not like, you know what? I'm going to the gym tomorrow. I already feel stronger. You feel, oh, whoa, hello, bicep. Where did that come from? All I did was think about and decide I'm going to the gym tomorrow, and all of a sudden, the improvement. That's not when the improvement comes. The improvement comes somewhere down the road as we consistently commit to the area in our life we want to improve. And if there's a word that's synonymous with improvement, I think it would be fight. Because if we're going to improve, we're going to have to fight to improve. Because everything that, isn't it funny? You decide you want to improve something, and it seems like everything is fighting against you for you to do that. Like, I want to improve my physical, and I feel like that's something I'm always wanting to improve. And then someone gifts me Cadbury cream eggs because it's around Easter time. And I'm like, and I don't want to be rude. I can turn down the eggs, so I obviously have to eat all five of them right now because they're here in front of me. And we can probably put that widespread in our lives. Maybe it's an area of temptation we're trying to run from, and it seems to be right in front of us, or the opportunity seems to be right in front of us the moment we decide no more. And it seems like everything is fighting against us. So if we're going to improve, we're going to have to be willing to fight. That's where breakthrough happens, as you continue to fight. Now, I don't know about you, breakthrough for me has become this Christian trigger word that we're supposed to have, believe for, fight for, but then somewhere along the way, it's gotten so overused. You ever hear a song on the radio, you're like, that is my jam. This is my favorite song ever. And then 2 weeks later, I hate this song. Oh, I hate it. Why? Because I've heard it 700,000 times in the last 2 weeks. And what used to be my jam is just old, used, and not relevant to me anymore. Sometimes we're at risk of doing that with words like this, breakthrough. It gets overused or improperly used, and it starts to lose its oomph. When in reality, God has not gotten out of the business of breakthrough in our lives. Sometimes we have just mislabeled it in different areas of our lives, because God is still a God who offers us breakthrough, because he says things like we are more than conquerors. So, and similar to what we're going to see here in the book of Joshua, God has prepared and promised breakthrough for all of his people. So just quickly, I want to discuss three quick things to keep in mind as we hope for breakthrough, as we hope for progress, as we hope for improvement in our lives. Number one is this. In the midst of hoping for breakthrough, eventually we're going to have to face facts. The facts. Joshua 1, verses 1 and 2 says this. It says, after the death of Moses. You ever heard the name Moses? Even if you're new to Bible, never even read the Bible, you probably heard of a guy named Moses. Maybe one of the most significant characters we read about in the Old Testament, as God's people were being set free from bondage in Egypt, as God's people were wandering in the wilderness, as God's people were seeking something from God, Moses is so often the one we see leading the charge in a lot of those places. And right here in the beginning of Joshua, we see that he's dead. He's not around anymore. Now, it's kind of like, this is a very much low stakes comparison, but it's kind of like when your favorite sportser retires. Like, I still remember when Michael Jordan retired, I was like, no, why? God, why? Good luck whoever follows this guy. Because those are some big shoes to fill. So you can imagine being the person or the people that are now around after Moses has passed away. It says, after the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant. Fun fact, Joshua was the assistant to the regional manager. Verse 2 says this, Moses, my servant, is dead. This is the Lord talking to Joshua. Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River into the land I am giving them. Moses is dead. He's gone. Joshua, it's on you now. It can be sometimes hard to face the fact that we're facing what we're facing. I think sometimes the biggest struggle is simply accepting the fight that we find ourselves in versus, no. No. Okay, I know, I get it. Moses is gone. I'll be interim leader, God. I'll be interim until we find who we need to find for this reason, this purpose. I guess I'll go ahead and be the interim leader, but it can't be me. It can't, and the longer we fight against what we know and believe and sense that God is calling us to, the longer the frustration will kind of like, And sometimes facing the fact that we find ourselves in the struggle we're in is the hardest part. Because I think as well, as far as the church goes, as far as Christians go, we've become really bad at thinking there are certain problems we shouldn't face anymore because we've been following Jesus for a certain amount of time. Like, this is a year one issue. We view our walk with Jesus as a career, as a vocation, and we sometimes think that because we're in year 20, I should be better than to face the problems I'm facing in year one. If you've grown up around church, at least Pentecostal church, maybe you've heard this phrase, new levels, new devils. The idea behind that phrase is when you get to new levels in your life, there's new devils and new attack and new fill in the blank that come. Sometimes that's the biggest misdirection that we believe because it's new levels, same devil. And he's probably going to try to come at you just like he's been coming at you since day one. You're just in a new area and space in your life, so the tendency is to believe you've graduated past the devil. Now, the devil has no right or ability to have any ground in your life that you don't give him. So I'm not saying that we don't outgrow the devil in terms of he has victory in our lives sometimes and doesn't others. He doesn't have any. But what I'm saying is we don't graduate past him coming after us. So it's not new levels, new devils. It's really new levels, same devil. But we've convinced ourselves that because we've been in this place for X amount of time, I should no longer struggle with this. I've lived in Albuquerque now for 25 years. I do not need GPS to get around the city. At least I tell myself, I do not need GPS to get around the city. Now, 95% of the time is true. I've had a lot of jobs here that have required me to learn the layout of the city as well, delivery, in-home service calls for different things. So I've had a lot of jobs that have given me the opportunity to learn the city real well. So I'm at the point now where, yo, just give me the cross streets. I will find my way there. Just give me the cross streets. Give me the address. I know when the numbers go up. I know when the numbers go down. I know where the center of the city is. I know what the northwest is, northeast, southwest, south. Like, I got it. Just give me. But there's been a few times. How many of you know if you lived in Albuquerque, certain parts of town? Don't want to be driving through after the sun goes down. May not be a good idea for the pride to well up. I don't need GPS. I know where to find. So there's those few times, and every time it happens to me, every time I get a little turned around, I tell myself, I've lived here for 25 years. Why am I lost? I shouldn't be lost. I've been in this place for 25 years. But the truth is, no matter how long I've been in this place, there is still something I need to be reliant on to get me out of places that I find myself in, no matter how long I've been here. For me, it's Google Maps. Apple Maps is garbage. It's garbage. It's garbage. It doesn't tell you where an arroyo is. It doesn't tell you when a street is just no longer a street, but it'll guide you through there. So for me, my salvation is Google Maps. Apple is a superior product overall, don't get me wrong. But there's still something that I need to be reliant upon no matter how long I walk through because it wasn't my strength that got me there in the first place. It's not going to be my strength that gets me through this newest moment of feeling lost. Just because we are Christians, no matter how long, doesn't mean you're not going to face issues and problems in year 20 that you faced in year one. My hope is, and what I'm trying to learn, is that we don't become too prideful when we get there in the bad neighborhood and say, I don't need GPS, I can get us out of here. Maybe, maybe not. Why would I not accept the strength and help that is there for me when I'm sometimes too prideful to say, I got this? It's not new levels, new devils. It's new levels, same devil. And sometimes when we find, like when I find myself in a place where I'm lost, often what got me there is I stopped doing the things that helped me get there. Wow. I feel like I've grown past it, or I've done it so much that it's solid. And so when we find ourselves in a season of feeling lost, go back to the things that got you to the place where you weren't lost. And sometimes it's so simple, like a Google map. Sometimes it's so simple, like going to God, praying. There's the internet is a dangerous place, isn't it? It's full of theologians. It's full of influencers. It's full of all kinds of stuff. Now, it's not. I'm not going to be too old man-ish and be like, oh, the internet. But it does have some dark corners. Some of the dark corners is that we take our cue for what we believe about God from things that are posted online without actually any real substance to it. For instance, there's one that I love. When I say love, I mean hate. That I see often, and it's this boasting of God. I'm not coming here today to ask you for anything, just to say I love you, and just to say thank you. Look at me. I'm so good at being a Christian. I don't even need anything from you, God. I don't want anything from you. I just want to say thank you. And can I tell you that that's going to sound nice in heaven, but here, I don't know about you. Good God, do I need God? And good God, do I want God? Do I want things from God? Yeah. Absolutely. Do I need things from God? Yeah. Absolutely. And I'll never stop needing or wanting things from God. But stuff like that has caused our subconscious almost to believe that we should feel guilty for going to God when we need something. Why wouldn't I go to God when I need something, when it says he's there for my needs? Why wouldn't I go to God when I want something? At the very least, he's going to say, yeah, you may want that, but you don't need it. Versus already convincing myself that I'm a good enough Christian. God, I've asked you for too much already. You've done too much. Here I am, Lord. I just love you. Thank you, Jesus. I don't need anything. I'd be the guy in line. Okay, can I get his stuff? If he doesn't, I'll take it, please. I need some of that strength. I need some of that ability to overcome that temptation. I need some of that Google Mapness to get me out of the mess that I got myself in, because I wasn't taking your directions anyway. I was just taking my ability to navigate my way through life. Found myself in a dangerous neighborhood. Lord, please help get me out of here. And thank God he's not a God who's sitting there like, nope, got yourself into it. Get yourself out of it. I might do that with somebody. Thank God he doesn't do that with somebody. So it is not a sin and it is not a shame to go to God for something that we need. It's actually what he tells us to do. Also, when we're navigating out of the place where we feel lost, confused, fill in the blank, it's pretty important to know where we are, to face where we are, in order to find ourselves like back out. It's helpful to retrace your steps. Anybody have lost anything? First thing you do is someone asks you, well, where's the last place you saw it? Don't you get mad at that question? If I knew that, I would not be looking for it. Well, retrace your steps and it might come to you. Instead of being so stubborn, if I knew where I'd love to have it. I had a coworker back in the day. We did service calls for the same company. And we would always joke about our customer interactions, because sometimes it's therapeutic to just trash talk the customers you deal with. Amen? Yeah. Amen. So we go. We were talking about customers when this was back in the day. We didn't have Google Maps. We had a map book. All right, there we go. That's where it is. But sometimes the street wouldn't be in the map book because it got outdated seemingly 6 months after it was published. And so you had to get it. So we didn't always have the street, so we'd have to occasionally call the customer saying, hey, such and such, I'm looking for your house. Just give me some directions. And he would always joke that every time he would call a customer and ask them for directions to their house, their response would be like, well, where are you coming from? And he would always have this snarky comeback. And you'd be like, why? Does it change where you are? Right? Sometimes dealing with customers just turns you into something that you didn't think you were. But he would kind of have that snarky comeback, like, you know, is where you're at, or does where I'm coming from change where you're at? And my response to him would always like, well, no, but it might give them some clue on how to get to you, or for you to get to them. And we see here that before Joshua could move forward into what's next, which is commanding God's people, he had to face facts with where he currently was and where God's people currently were. Moses is no longer here. God is now called me to be in this place where I'm at. And what I believe that translates to us for today, I don't know the struggle you're in, but I know you're in a struggle. I don't know the confusion, the feeling of lost that you're in, but I know it's there. Sometimes it's at 10, sometimes it's at 1, but I know because we live in this world that it's there. And can I tell you, being honest and facing the facts of where you're at will aid tremendously in God leading you out of it. We're not taking on our own strength to get us out of something, but when we face facts with where we are, instead of putting on, well, I've been following the Lord for X amount of years, I can't be in this place, is only going to make it more confusing and frustrating for you to get out of it if you don't face facts with where you currently are. And before Joshua could move forward into what was next, he had to face facts about where he currently found himself. And in hoping for a breakthrough, that's what we need to do. We need to face where we are, not where we were, not where we want to be, not where we're telling ourselves we are, but where we actually are. Being a teenager and getting lost, I remember I was scared to death, to be honest with my parents. Like, cell phone died, don't have a ride. Dad, can you come pick me up? Where are you at? Oh. Church? I think I'm at church. Do you pick me up at church? I'm at this party. I felt the need to hide where I was from my dad because I was more worried about his disappointment in where I was than rescue from where I was. When in reality, we don't have to hide the fact of our Heavenly Father being disappointed in where we're at. We just got to be honest. The beautiful thing about our Heavenly Father, too, is he already knows where you're at. So lying is not going to help anything. And it is a pretty silly thing to do, but I get it because we all have this innate shame that we deal with that has been around since day one. So it's not saying feel guilty for feeling it, but just don't let it direct you. We've got to face facts so that we can persevere. Number two is we have to take on the tension. Take on the tension. I'll tell you what that tension is here in just a moment. Joshua verses 1, or chapter 1, verses 3 and 4 says this. This is God still speaking to Joshua. He says, I promise you what I promised Moses. Wherever you set foot, you will be on the land I have given you. Wherever you set foot, you will be on the land I have given you, from the Negev wilderness in the south to the Lebanon mountains in the north, from the Euphrates River in the east to the Mediterranean Sea in the west, including all the land of the Hittites. Wherever you set foot, you will be on land I have given you. After God reminded Joshua that Moses wasn't around and that he's up and he is to be the leader of his people, Joshua is now tasked with leading God's people into the land that God had given them. Think about that statement. He had to lead them into land that he had already given them. In our minds sometimes, like, well, if it's ours, then why the struggle? If it's the land that God you've already given, can I just have it? You said you gave it to me, like, mira, give it to me. Let me have it. So that I can have it because you said it's mine. Joshua was tasked with leading God's people into something that already belonged to them. Interesting about the land of God, the land that God had for his people, that it was already theirs, but they were going to have to be led into it. It was already theirs, but they were going to have to fight for it. It was already theirs, but they were going to have to fight to possess it. They were going to have to fight to keep it. They were going to have to go through struggle and persevere through things in order to be in the land that God had given them. It kind of goes against this entitlement mentality that we struggle with. It's like, well, if something's mine, I should just have it. I shouldn't have to do anything to keep it. It's mine. And we view things in a possessive way, like it's ours. But we have to remember, like, it's ours because he's given it to us. It is not ours innately just because we're us. It is ours because God has given it to us. It was their land because God had given it to them. It's pretty hard to fathom, though, that something can simultaneously be yours, but you still have to fight for it. Hold on a second. In like our literal intellectual age, where words are everything, and we want to literally define everything, even though we don't have the capacity to actually define everything, we want to define everything in a way that either makes sense to us or works out for us. And so we're like, well, it's mine. Just let me have it. But we have to take on the tension of these two truths without pitting them against each other. The breakthrough is yours. True. You're going to have to fight for it. True. These are not competing ideas. They're actually complementing ones in the kingdom of God. We have some of our best friends, Justin and Sarah, who they held on to a promise. And if you know them, you know a little bit of their story. They held on to a promise for a long, long time that they were going to have children. And for a long season in their life, they struggled with it. But they knew the promise. They knew the promise, even though it wasn't happening in their lives. And I think one of the most encouraging and inspiring things about their journey is as they were waiting for the promise, it wasn't passive. It wasn't, okay, God, you promised it. I'll wait. You said you were going to do it. Why am I going to do anything? Well, I mean, in order to have a baby, you got to do something. The inspiring thing about watching them in that journey is that they weren't just passive and said, okay, God, you promised it, you better deliver. It was like, no, God promised it. We know the promise. We're going to fight for it. And it set them off on this journey of doing everything in their power to walk in the promise that God had already given them. You see, sometimes when we get the promise, we want to define the process to get to the promise when we don't even know what it looks like other than I need to do everything in my power to do what I need to do to walk in the promise that God has already delivered. And it's sometimes in our linear way of thinking, it doesn't make sense. But can I tell you, anything from the kingdom of God on the outside of the kingdom of God doesn't make sense? None of it does. If you're looking at it outside the kingdom or with a perspective, you can be in the kingdom with an outside kingdom perspective, looking at things on the kingdom and being like, no, none of it makes sense. So either God is a liar or maybe I'm just looking at it wrong. Maybe I'm thinking about it wrong. The land is yours, but you're going to have to fight for it. And it's pretty amazing that they have two of those promises here living with them right now. It's this tension. It's taking on this tension of knowing it's yours, but you're going to have to fight for it. You can't delegate the fight. You can't abdicate your responsibility in the fight. But it's hard. It can be hard to fathom when you are the one that God has called to lead you through your own problems. We want someone else to win the fight for us. Don't we? And we're really good at churchifying it. Like, sometimes we say and praise God for winning the victory for us, but it's out of the point of view of not doing anything about it. There's a difference between when you're praising God, Lord, thank you for the victory, because I'm in this fight. I'm on my way, and I'm moving forward. Thank you for the victory. I'm going to keep fighting, versus thank you for the victory. Why am I still fighting? One's an entitlement. One's a belief. One is a posture of faith. One is a posture of God, can someone just do it for me? And this is where we must learn to accept the fact that God must know what he's doing a little more than we do. Because often I don't think it's out of sheer laziness, although sometimes it probably is. I mean, I love lazy days just as much as the next person. But I don't think it's always out of sheer laziness that we're unwilling to fight for what God has promised for us. Sometimes I think it's out of, like, intimidation, insecurity. Like, God, I'm facing this. I can't win this battle. There's absolutely no way. And that's where you have to take the tension. Like, you don't have to lean on your own strength, but you do have to have your participation in it while leaning on his strength. Your biggest piece of interpretation or participation may be leaning on his strength, though, as you continue to move forward. And so sometimes I think it's just intimidation or insecurity that, God, you got me out here in this place. There's no way I can get out of it. There's no way that I'm the one you've sent to lead me through this, to lead my struggles through this. But that's where we have to learn to accept the fact that God must knows what he's doing a little more than we do. I've got to believe in those moments that God's ways are more powerful than my imposter syndrome, than my thinking, oh, I got to go out here and pretend to be faith-filled. I got to go out here and pretend that I know how to lean on God to get me through this struggle. I got to go out here and pretend to worship when everything around me is falling apart. That doesn't make you fake, by the way, to worship when life is a mess. It means you're filled with faith on the one who can get you through your problems. So don't worry if someone's looking at you like they're worshiping Jesus. I know what they were doing last night. What were they doing last night in the midst of their struggle? How dare they? So one, if you're in the business of judging someone else when they're worship, stop it. Like, cut it out. It's not helping. But don't you dare let what someone else is thinking about your worship keep you from worshiping. Don't do it. I've got to believe that God's ways are more powerful than my imposter syndrome. Accepting the fact that you're the one that God has called you to in your own life lead through your issues is not arrogance, by the way. It's confidence. It's confidence that can only be given by God. I mean, I think about the times in my life I've had to persevere. Whether it's, you know, hard times in our marriage that we persevere through, because any married couple has those times where it's like, all right, things are good, but this is hard. Or things are bad and also hard. What are we gonna do? My kids are growing up into this age. I don't know what to do with them. What am I gonna do? It's hard. I sometimes just want someone else to fix it. I want to contract the fight. When my plumbing goes out, I ain't trying to fix it. I'm going to call somebody who knows how to fix it. And sometimes I fall into that way of thinking in my own life. Who can I call to fix this? Jesus, come fix my marriage. Our hope and belief that Jesus can change everything can't turn into the expectation that he's going to do your part for you. He can fix it. You got to fight for it, though. He will fix it. You've got to fight for it, though. And in the midst of hardship, I'm often reminded of a conversation I had with a friend of mine. He's in our Every Nation family of churches, which is the global family of churches that we're a part of. It's a guy named Ernie Kruger. He's from South Africa. He's charismatic. He's faith-filled. And some of the stories I hear about him, and he's got a super cool accent. He's done a lot of different work. Right now, he's the national director for our campus ministry on college campuses. And I remember wanting to start a campus ministry and knowing that that was part of our inheritance of the family of churches that we're a part of, to have a campus ministry. But for a long time, it was hard. Like, we didn't have anybody to do it. And a couple years ago, I was like, okay, we're going to do this. We're going to start a campus ministry. Who's going to come start our campus ministry? And so I started making calls, like headhunting. Started making calls to different campus missionaries around the country. Like, hey, you want to come to Albuquerque? You want to come to UNM? Apparently, Albuquerque is a tough sell. I don't know. I don't know what would be. I love it. I love it. Who's going to come? Who's gifted here? Who's called here? Who can do it? Who's going to come and do this for us? I felt like Jerry Maguire when he sang, like, who's coming with me? Who's coming with me? Nobody was coming. And I remember being at an event with Ernie, and I was talking to him. I said, man, I'm having tough. And you know, like, I was trying to, the word I'm looking for is manipulate, I think. I was trying to manipulate. I was trying to be like, man, dude, it's hard. Sure wish someone would come and help. I was fishing, not for him, but I knew he knew somebody that could come and start a campus ministry. I knew he knew somebody. And in the midst of this conversation, he finally stopped me and he was like, Matt, dude, no one else is coming. Get out on the campus. No one else is coming to do it for you. So if that's what you're waiting for, you're gonna be waiting for a while. And I'm like, you're so rude. I don't know how they do things in South Africa, but we have a little more manners here. So I'd appreciate if you weren't so rude to me, to my face like that. At least wait till I leave. And I walked away like, what the nerve of that guy. I can't believe no one else is coming. Until God reminded me of this passage in Joshua. And I don't see anywhere in Joshua where Joshua is looking around like, who's going to do this? Okay, we got to get across the Jordan. We got to get who? And Joshua kind of had to come to this realization. No one else is coming because God has called you. The land is yours. You're going to have to fight for it. Your marriage, your purpose, your identity, your breakthrough is yours, but you're going to have to fight for it. We've got to face facts. We've got to take on the tension. And finally, we have to begin to work it out. Verses 5 through 10 says this, no one will be able to stand against you as long as you live, for I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail you or abandon you. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one who will lead these people to possess all the land I swore to their ancestors I would give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave to you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you will be successful in everything you do. How do you fight? Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the left or the right. Then you will be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night, so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. You see, that passage of scripture right there is not designed to teach you how to be someone who's worthy of being a child of God. That passage of scripture is designed to give you tools and weapons to fight with. How do we fight? Meditate on it day and night. Allow it to lead you. Verse 9, this is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord God is with you wherever you go. My favorite part, verse 10, Joshua then commanded the officers of Israel. God spoke to Joshua, assured him. Then Joshua faced it. He accepted it. He held that tension, and then he commanded the people. If you're feeling stuck or discouraged in whatever battle, whatever struggle, whatever hardship, whatever thing you feel like you need to persevere through in your life, let me give you some encouragement that Ernie gave me. No one else is coming. And it's not out of abandonment that no one else is coming, but out of confirmation that you're the one God has already sent. Think about this for a second. God sent Jesus at just the right time. Exact time in history that he needed to be sent. God then sent the Holy Spirit after Jesus came and fulfilled his purpose on earth. Then he sent the Holy Spirit. Then the church started. The only thing else we're waiting for is Jesus to come back. So think about that. He already sent Jesus. He already sent the Holy Spirit. Jesus hasn't come back yet. That must mean you, with the Holy Spirit, is enough to get through the problems you're going through right now. You ever hear like, Jesus, just come back. Now, I get it, because sometimes I'm like, Lord, yes, please, just can we call it a day? Can we call it a life? Can we call it a, just come. But think about that. You are actually the one you've been waiting for. Because you're filled with the Holy Spirit. You have everything that you need that God has promised to this point to get through what you're going through. No one else is coming, not out of abandonment, but out of confirmation. I feel like once I realize in those times that no one else is coming, I sort of have to believe that I'm the one who God has already sent. Think about this. Three times in a few verses, God tells Joshua to be strong and courageous. He actually says, be strong and courageous. The second time he says, be strong and very courageous. And then he caps it off by saying, be strong and courageous. And something that has always sat with me and wrestled with me is like, why in the middle? Why on the second time does he say, be strong and very courageous? Be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous. And right here in the middle, be strong and very courageous. And I honestly think, I've seen this true in my life at least, is because it's harder to continue being courageous than to start or finish being courageous. It is really hard in the middle of the mess, of the struggle, to be very courageous. Because we've been courageous and we're still in it. Nothing's working. It's in the middle that usually we need that extra tweak of encouragement to be very courageous. And once you realize that no one else is coming, not out of abandonment, but out of confirmation to help you get through whatever it is you're going through, we kind of have to believe this idea in Romans 8:28, where it says God is working all things out for the good of those who love him. And now at this point, once I get that, I almost naively get filled with faith again. Like get filled with, some people call it crazy faith. I like to call it stupid faith. Like I get filled with stupid faith that doesn't make any sense of why I believe that I'm going to get through whatever I'm going through, because I have no logical or earthly evidence to believe that I'm going to get through what I'm going through. All I have is this promise from God to be strong and very courageous, and that I am working things out for your good. Once that happened, like I don't become careless, but I do begin to care less about the things I think that might prevent me from moving forward. It's okay for those thoughts to swirl. Am I good enough? Can I do this? What are people gonna think? What are people gonna do? Are people gonna leave? Are people gonna stay? It's okay for those thoughts to swirl, but don't let them settle. Don't let them settle in, because here's, Jesus has come. We have the Holy Spirit. So as far as it pertains to struggles in this life, can I give you the secret sauce? You are who you have been waiting for. And this isn't faith in my own strength. What it is an acceptance that God must actually be capable of doing something in and through me that I didn't think before. The problem isn't what you think. The problem isn't that you aren't enough or that you aren't the right person for the job. The problem in part is that you haven't faced the facts and accepted that you probably are the biggest answer to your problems. God is called you. God will be with you. God has gone before you, but he will not go for you. Don't take on the pressure of the outcome. Just take on the responsibility for the work to get there. Moses is dead. No one's coming. Your breakthrough is waiting on you because you have the power that raised Christ from the dead living on the inside of you. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes for just a moment? Now, it's interesting because all of this is, it's really contingent on that last statement. You have the power that raised Christ from the dead living on the inside of you. When you have that, you are who you've been waiting for to get through your struggles. If you've never made that moment, that choice of surrender and inviting and accepting the power of Christ to come live on the inside of you, I want to tell you, that is your biggest answer to anything you're facing right now. And if you have made that choice, you would call yourself a Christ follower, a Christian. You've been born again. I want to remind you, even though sometimes you feel powerless, that power never leaves you. Even though at times you feel like there's nothing else you can do, you've still got the power that raised Christ from the dead living on the inside of you. So if that's the case and you feel you're in this season where you feel lost, just go back to doing what you know to do. Go back to the Father. Go back to the Word. Go back to your prayer life. Go back to surrendering to Jesus. Go back to repentance. Go back to confession. Go back to all these things. God, we thank you so much for sending your Son Jesus to live the life that we should have lived and died the death that we should have died in our place. Thank you, Lord, that 3 days later, Jesus didn't stay there, but he rose from the dead, proving that he is the Son of God, offering the free gift of salvation for anyone who would repent and believe. And if that's you right now, I'm not going to ask you even to raise your hand, come up. I'm just going to ask you to take a moment with Jesus. Let him speak to you. Let him direct you. And for those of you that maybe have already made that decision at some point in your life, just take a moment. And go back to him. He's waiting. He's not disappointed in you. He's not embarrassed by you. He's not ashamed of you. He's actually waiting with open arms and a robe and a ring and all the things that he has for you, not the things you think he'll use against you. Jesus, thank you for your goodness. Thank you for salvation in you. In Jesus' name, amen.